but here again we shivered at the awful sight of the bodies. We determined to free ourselves therefrom by throwing them overboard, but how were we startled to find that no one could move them from their places. So firmly were they fastened to the floor that to remove them one would have had to take up the planks of the deck, for which tools were wanting to us. The captain, moreover, could not be loosened from the mast, nor could we even wrest the saber from his rigid hand. We passed the day in sorrowful reflection on our condition, and when night began to draw near, I gave permission to the old Ibrahim to lie down to sleep, while I would watch upon the deck to look out for means of deliverance. When, however, the moon shone forth, and by the stars I calculated that it was about the 11th hour, sleep so irresistibly overpowered me that I fell back, involuntarily, behind a cask which stood upon the deck. It was rather lethargy than sleep, for I plainly heard the sea beat against the side of the vessel and the sails creak and whistle in the wind. All at once, I thought I heard voices and the steps of men upon the deck. I wished to arise and see what it was, but a strange power fettered my limbs, and I could not once open my eyes. But still more distinct became the voices. It appeared to me as if a merry crew were moving around upon the deck. In the midst of this, I thought I distinguished the powerful voice of a commander, followed by the noise of ropes and sails. Gradually my senses left me. I fell into a deep slumber, in which I still seemed to hear the din of weapons, and awoke only when the sun was high in the heavens, and sent down his burning rays upon my face.